Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Washerwoman's Dream, written by Hilarie Lindsay and read by Julie Nihill. To Philip Lindsay for his unfailing support. Acknowledgements. I wish to thank all those who helped me with material for this book, especially Nancy Flannery, née Robinson, who preserved the Winifred Steger manuscripts. Stella Guthrie, who taped interviews with Winifred Steger from the late 1970s until just before Winifred's death in 1981, and, like Nancy, allowed me full access to this material. Thanks also to the Steger family, Elizabeth Guy, Linnie Plate, Jose Petrick, John Delvitz, Horry Simpson, Ray Sexton, Helen Baker, the late Margaret Potts, Dr. Cedric Gregory, Sister Rose Barnes, John Rawsthorne, R.M. Williams, R.K. Bailey, Rene Paisy, Roy Luke, Shirley McPherson, the late Ian Wood, Suzanne Gervais, Moya Simons, Vashti Farah, and Natalie Scott from the Hughenden Gargoyles, Dr. Patricia Gout, and those who listened, Professor Elizabeth Webby, my supervisor at Sydney University while I worked on my doctoral thesis, my editor, Julia Stiles, my agent, Selwa Anthony, and the many others who answered my letters, sent me photographs and other material, and generally shared my enthusiasm for Winifred Steger. I am grateful for the assistance of the staff from the following institutions in Australia: the Mitchell Library, State Library of New South Wales, La Trobe Library, State Library of Victoria, the John Oxley Library, State Library of Queensland, the Mortlock Library, State Library of South Australia, the Toowoomba Library, the Australian Archives, South Australia, the South Australian Archives, the Australian Genealogical Society, the National Library, the Queensland State Archives, the Toowoomba Family History Society, the Dalby Family History Society, the Roma and District Family History Society, Fisher Library, University of Sydney, the Morven Historical Museum, the Mount Horrocks Historical Society, the Chinchilla Historical Society, the Alice Springs Library, the Public Library of Port Augusta, the Archives of the Presbyterian Church, Queensland, the Archives of the Alice Springs Hospital, the Country Women's Association, South Australia, the South Australian Theosophical Society, Udnadatta Hospital and Health Services, the Islamic Society of South Australia, the Sydney Morning Herald, Australia All Over, ABC Radio, and the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, South Australia, State Heritage Branch. I also acknowledge the assistance of the following institutions in Great Britain: the Genealogical Society, the Minay Library, Lambeth, the Public Records Office, Kew, the Public Records Office, Chancery Lane, St. Catherine's House, the Greater London Records Office, and the British Library. Author's note. On the 1st of November 1929, the Register, South Australia, published a page from Winifred's Indian diary. It is probable that Winifred Steger kept a diary at other times, but if so, I did not have access to it. There were no diaries among the Steger papers in the Mortlock Library. Suddenly, from deep within my head, the images appear like moving pictures on a screen. Strange places never been, strange faces never seen. Others I never thought to see again, father and mother, sister and brother, and stretching forth my hand, I feel their living presence in the room. Until I wake, the same sharp pain returns, the sense of loss that makes the hot tears burn. I sleep again. Once more in dreams, my restless spirit journeys deep into the country of the mind, as if in constant search some truth I'll find, some secret door that unlocked will reveal which of the two lives that I live is real. The Country of the Mind, Hilarie Lindsay. One of the hardest punishments is to be thrown into the world with aspirations and dreams that cannot be fulfilled for want of education. I received only a few weeks' schooling. Ignorant and alone, I lived in a world of make-believe. Winifred Steger. Introduction. I first met Winifred Steger when she was coming to the end of her long journey, a journey that was to span almost a century. In 1973, I had seen her interviewed on This Day Tonight, ABC TV, when the paperback version of her book about her trip to Mecca, Always Bells, Life with Ali, was published. She was asked what she would say to younger writers. "Grow mentally," she replied. Her story captured my imagination, and as president of the Society of Women Writers, SWW, I wrote to congratulate her and to invite her to become a special member of the society. Winifred accepted the invitation and we began to correspond. At the time, I had developed a special interest in Australian women writers because so many complained of difficulty in being published or even writing. In 1971, I had written a letter to the newspapers in Australia, as well as the New York and London Times, inviting women writers who had experienced difficulty in getting published to write to me. In the first month, I received 400 letters, and they continued to pour in until I was overwhelmed by what I had started. The letters, some written by relatives, confirmed what I had suspected. Women spoke of outright opposition from husbands and male relatives, to the extent of being forbidden to write under their married name. Others spoke of lack of education, isolation, domestic work that consumed all their time and energy, and the problem of finding money for postage to send their work out. There was a feeling of deep frustration. Out of all the women writers I encountered in my research, it was Winifred Steger who impressed me the most. It was her indomitable spirit, her refusal to bow to old age, and the fact that she was still writing and could express herself so lucidly that captured my imagination. I had no idea of the full story of her life, but one of her letters gave me a tantalizing glimpse. "Dear lady, today you wrote with your spirit and I felt it, and somehow when I came to the signature affectionately, my eyes dimmed. It was a touch from some never-never land. This emotional life grows strange fancies. I am a relic, I suppose, of the old Victorian days. It would have been easier had I some silver trumpeter. I am, briefly, just an aged woman of 94, born in 1882, Winifred was in fact 91, who since I could first write my letters have had a simple compulsion to write. Maybe I was a writer in a past life, and maybe shall be a better one in the next one. At least I hope to have the sophisticated education that editors desire now. I feel dimly that I have a message but don't know what it is, and there you have the odd, complicated character that I know myself to be. My first real effort at writing was when I was 15. Shaw Fitchett of London brought out his new magazine called Life, a traveller on Cobb and Co., lost it on a lonely bush road. I found it. Reading it was marvellous. Something within me said, you too can write, so get to it. With pencil and paper, I sat down and wrote The Adventures of a Bee and a Blue Bag. Oh yes, frightfully crude. A couple of months later came a check for £1 and my story in the next issue entitled From a Rough Diamond, and urging me to write again. Wildly excited, I wrote another and this time added a title and it was printed. I was an unloved and neglected child left to battle alone. My first experience with real people was when at 10 years, I was put with outsiders to work at sixpence a week, later rising to a full half a crown. My only joy was in writing on paper scraps from the ends of books or the back of envelopes. Years, marriage, children, troubles and hardships, need I go on? Till finally I went disguised as a Turkish woman to the forbidden lands of Mecca. I loved my Muslim and insisted on going also, and he so loved me that he consented. It's all so long ago. Returning to Australia, I had met Annie Besant in India, so was asked to speak in the Adelaide Theosophical Hall, which I did 2 Sundays running. The reporter came the second Sunday, and after our return to Camelia life, I was asked to write for the Register. Then Ali died, and the fight was mine. I took out a hawker's license and toured the far north cattle properties. Then a history of punctured tyres, broken parts, shortage of water, etc., etc. I left the north after running various government messes during the war. I bought a little place near Clare and again more writing. From serials, I started novels. 3 I gave free to clear newspapers, 80,000 word jobs. Took 3 years to finish publishing them. May I add that the criticisms of Always Bells were magnificent. Of my journey to Mecca, the book tells. I feel as if I could put another cushion on the chair and write another dozen novels straight off. I'm not dead yet, and have 14 unwanted novels in the box. Give me another 100 years and I might have them accepted. As it is, the God of Fire will have a glorious glowing feast. Anyway, why worry? I believe in reincarnation, and when I come back, I mean to paint this old firmament in black shades of printer's ink. As our correspondence continued, I discovered that Winifred had another identity as Winifred the Washerwoman, a pseudonym she continued to use long after she had ceased to be a washerwoman to thumb her nose at the world. If the world despised the washerwoman engaged in honest toil, did it also despise Winifred the Washerwoman, the writer behind the warm and witty articles that engaged readers for many years in the Register and Chronicle in South Australia and the Sun in Victoria? In 1976, I travelled to Adelaide to launch a branch of the Society of Women Writers, SWW, and invited Winifred to attend the meeting. I recall a sprightly woman in a blue dress, wearing a white wig. She was surprised to discover that I was much younger than she had imagined. "I was thinking we could have collaborated," she said. It was our only meeting. Later, I tried to find a publisher for her novels without success. When she threatened to burn them, I contacted the staff at the National Library who offered to buy them. But that was not to be. Winifred had only one ambition, to see them in print. Eventually, Winifred's letters ceased, and I had no idea of what happened to her, though she stayed in my mind. By this time, my life had moved on. Then in 1992, I began a Master of Philosophy degree at Sydney University. Initially, I intended to use the material I had collected on women writers as the basis for my thesis. However, Winifred soon began to take over, and I realized my thesis was, in fact, a biography of her extraordinary life. My one difficulty was that I had nothing but her letters and a few tear sheets she had sent me of her 3 serials, which had been published in the Clare's Northern Argus. In 1993, I wrote to Helen Baker, a member of the SWW in Adelaide, to see if she knew what had happened to Winifred. She referred me to Stella Guthrie, who had interviewed Winifred for rural ABC radio, recording interviews with the old writer until just before her death in 1981. Like many who met Winifred, Stella had fallen in love with her, and she offered to lend me the tapes on the proviso that I speak to Winifred's daughter, Pansy, first. From Pansy, I confirmed that the trip to Mecca had really happened, and that as a small child, she had accompanied her mother. But apart from a few anecdotes, she could tell me very little. "Mother was a very private person. She did not talk about her past," she said. This was something I was to hear repeated many times by other relatives. In addition to lending me the tapes, Stella referred me to Nancy Robertson of Najuri Press. From Nancy, I discovered that Winifred's manuscripts had not been burned on her death. Winifred had given them to Nancy in the hope of publication, and they were kept in the Mortlock Library, South Australia, for safekeeping. Nancy gave me permission to research them. They were in 10 cartons, and I began work immediately. As soon as I transcribed the Guthrie tapes, I discovered the first of Winifred's lies. The story told in Always Bells, about the author being found under a rose bush in China and raised first by Buddhist priests and then by nuns, was a falsehood. She had in fact been born in Lambeth, England, and she and her father had migrated to Queensland. I was to discover the reason for this deception when I read the correspondence between Winifred and Beatrice Davis of publishers Angus and Robertson. While Winifred was living on a poultry farm in Alice Springs after World War II, she rewrote the story of her trip to Mecca, which had been published as a serial in the South Australian Register, and entered it in a novel writing competition run by the Adelaide Advertiser under the title With Ibn Saud to Mecca. Though it did not win, one of the judges mentioned it to Beatrice Davis, who wrote to Winifred asking to see a copy of the manuscript. At the same time, the Advertiser offered to publish it as a serial. Eager to publish it as a book, Winifred accepted the offer from Angus and Robertson. It was published as an autobiography. Once the lie about her childhood and marriage to Ali, whom she claimed she had met in China before migrating to Australia, was published, Winifred was stuck with it. It was the story she told to those who met her after the publication of the book, a story she repeated in interviews with the media. Hoping to find some relatives of the Steger family, I advertised in the Sydney Morning Herald, but without success. My first breakthrough came when I found some early copies of the register at the Mitchell Library. These contained the serial she had written on Mecca under the title of Arabian Days, The Wanderings of Winifred the Washerwoman, with the byline Bibi Hadyana Karum Books. I wrote to Winifred's daughter to find out if Karum Books was her father and received a reply from her daughter asking me not to write to her mother again, as she had told me all she knew. I knew from the Guthrie tapes that Winifred had written a series called Stardust and Soap Bubbles for the Register, and that she had also used the pseudonym Sapphire Bill. I travelled to Adelaide and spent days looking through the microfiche until I found first Stardust and Soap Bubbles and then The Tales of Sapphire Bill, both running as weekly serials. I also researched in the State Library of Victoria and found that the Stardust and Soap Bubbles stories had been syndicated. I was unsuccessful in finding them in the Courier Mail, where Winifred claimed also to have published, but I have no doubt that they are there somewhere. Without dates, it is almost impossible to locate them. My second breakthrough came when a friend found out that Winifred's maiden name was Oaten, and I was able to get her birth certificate. From this, I learned that her father was Wilfred Oaten, son of a schoolmaster from Bath. Her mother was Louisa Dennis, whose address was given as 97 Tradescant Street, Lambeth. I went to England and found the house, one of a row of terraces which is still standing. I looked for a nearby school where Winifred may have had her early education and found Wivel Road School on the other side of South Lambeth Road, about a five-minute walk from Tradescant Street. I was unable to verify that Winifred had been a pupil there, as there are no records of this school in the archives of the Public Records Office in London. I could find no evidence of Winifred having attended school in Australia, though the John Darien school records seem to have disappeared. I believe Winifred's claim that the only schooling she had was in England is true. From the Guthrie tapes, I discovered that after migrating to Australia, Winifred had lived on the Darling Downs, Queensland, with her father. I wrote a letter to the Dalby Historical Society and received a letter back telling me about her marriage to Charles Steger and the birth of two sons. It was some time before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.